Today, I, Pramit Gupta, feel extremely privileged to welcome you all on the behalf of Jaipuria Institute of Management, Jaipur, for the Union Budget Analysis 2021 in collaboration with the Times of India. Post the corona pandemic, the whole nation has its eyes set on this budget, and that is why I am sure we all are here and looking forward for the discussion. The Union Budget for the financial year 2021-22 was announced by our Honorable Finance Minister, Mrs. Nirmala Sitharaman, on 1st Feb 2021. Before starting the event, I would like to seek the blessings of Goddess Saraswati, and I would request our esteemed guest to light the lamp. Kindly, he is an immediate past chairman of Thai Global, Board of the Trustee for the year 2020. In addition to this, he is also an angel investor and also involved in philanthropic activities. He has 30 plus years of working experience. We welcome you, sir, and as a part of Jaipuria tradition, we honor you with a green certificate, that is, a tree will be planted by your name in Baksa, Bihar, and you can track the growth of the tree by using the tracking ID given at the bottom. I would request our director, Dr. Prabhat Pankaj, to do the honor. Thank you so much, sir. Then we have Mr. Ranjan Thakur, Hospital Director, Manipal Hospital, Jaipur. He comes up with a tenure of 10 years of experience in driving healthcare excellence in domestic and international business unit. He has done his MBA from Axelerai Jamshedpur. He is a CA and a BTech. We welcome you, sir, with a green certificate, and I would request our Dean Academics, Dr. Anurag Singh, to do the honors. Welcome you, sir, with the green certificate, and I would request our program director, PGTM General, first year, Dr. Varun Chotia, to do the honors. With a teaching experience of more than 28 years in undergraduate level and postgraduate level. He has received a fellowship of Indian government and undertook the assignments and training in Europe, Thailand, Bangladesh, Bhutan, and Sri Lanka. He has obtained his executive education from Harvard University in Management and Leadership in Higher Education. We welcome you, sir. We are equally privileged to have our Dean Academics, Dr. Anurag Singh, as a panelist. He has done his PhD and MBA in finance. His research area includes corporate finance, corporate tax laws, merger and acquisition. He comes up with an experience of more than 20 years in teaching. We welcome you, sir. We also have Mr. Minal Kasturia, Branch Lead, Times of India, as our guest. We welcome you, sir, with a bouquet. At last, we have our session moderator, Mr. Kunal Majumda, resident editor, The Times of India. He is working with Times of India from last 16 years. He has 25 years of extensive working experience in journalism. We welcome you, sir, with the green certificate, and I would request our Dean. Northwestern Railways as our guest. We are very thankful to you, sir, that you managed to come here out of your busy schedule. Now I would request Anve Bhaga, Dr. Anve Bhaga, to welcome him with a bouquet.
On behalf of Times of India, Can you listen?
I welcome you all to this annual event. Budget, as it is, it's a vision document of the government for the coming 1 year, what they are planning to do and what, how, from where they want to get financing for the next 1 year. But due to Corona this year, my own personal assessment of the budget is that the finance minister has little scope to go for bold measures, and so she preferred not to surprise anybody and went for infrastructure growth, financing infrastructure growth, which she hopes that later on will help the overall economy, to boost the overall economy. So I will not waste much time, and I will one by one I will ask our panelists to give their assessment of the budget, and plus in the particular sector they are involved, they can stress on that sector also. But it will be very nice if they can give an overall assessment of the budget also. So let me start with Mr. Behl.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Good morning, everybody. Last night, I happened to ask two of our entry-level team members that, can you share something about the budget? Because, you know, today I had to come and give my thoughts on the budget. So they were like, sir, hamare palle nahi padta. And I was like, no, that's not a good enough answer. Let's, you know, delve a little deeper. Nahi, aap phir bhi bataiye. So then he took me to how he saw a YouTube video and he learned about the budget. There was, he had a lot of insights. And I believe we all here have our own opinions about the budget. Let's go a year back. We all have been impacted negatively because of COVID. Nobody has been left untouched. A lot of negative stuff has been happening around us. But today, let's focus on the positives. Now, when I say positives, 2 days before the budget, the Indian Economic Survey came out and it spoke about a V-shaped recovery. And I believe that there is a V-shaped recovery. I'm not an economist and I'm not here to tell you numbers. But if I look around, if you look around, everybody is out working. Our restaurant business, our catering business has bounced back, no doubt about that. And a lot of businesses around have bounced back. So at a micro level, there is certainly a V-shaped recovery, which seems promising. Now coming to the budget, I believe it's a very bold budget, very ambitious. Now, the key here is what you have been learning for 2 years now, execution. Execution of the budget is the most important thing. Yes, we are aware we are going to spend more on infrastructure, we are going to spend more on healthcare, but where the key lies, or the most critical thing, is execution. Like Peter Drucker said, vision without execution is delusion. It's all about results. So I think it's a great budget. You have all the numbers with you, or you can Google them. But all in all, I think we're going to get there. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Behl. We will now ask Mr. Ranjan Thakur his views on the budget.
Hi, everyone. I'd like to thank Mr.
Dr. Prabhat, first of all, for taking me around across this beautiful campus today. It's a lot of greenery, birds, ducks around. We typically don't see that when we get into budget, you know, figures, lakhs of crores, all of that. But always remember, we are 125 crore population, and even if that is 2 lakh odd crore, there is a healthcare spend which has gone up by, say, 137%, what it says, which is in the right direction, definitely. But if you divide it by the population, the amount may seem a little less. So yes, we are moving in the right direction. Since I come from hospital background, and because of COVID, so everything has pros and cons. And probably because of COVID, government, everybody around, general public, is much more serious or much more aware about what is the importance of health. Because we do maintenance of our cars. You get calls from Honda. If you own Honda City, please maintenance kara lijiye. But if somebody tells you that, no, get your health check screening done, you think, abhi kya hai? Jiyenge apan, huh? We have lot of life left around. So probably that seriousness has come into, and even if we correlate to our scriptures, they say we have four primary problems, which is Janm, Mrityu, Jara, Vyadhi. Janm is birth, and you know, if you talk to doctors, birth, the baby is very cramped inside the womb. We say it's a good news for all of us, but maybe the time baby spends, it usually gains consciousness around 7 months. So that 2 months is really difficult for him to be inside the womb. So you have birth, death, old age. Now these three typically you cannot avoid, right? It's bound to come. What we can work little bit on is disease. And I would again like to compliment the management here is they work a lot on wellness. They work on a lot on peace, happiness. I saw the first objective of this college is happiness. And then sir was explaining the last one is what probably goes after. You know, everybody runs after the results part. But if we are not really not taking care of us, our habits are not right, and probably that's where Mr. Modi came up with Yoga Day, to build up our habits. Changing habits is very difficult. So researcher says that it takes 60 days to build a habit, and if those habit we can build around health, is where the budget has lot of prominence this year. It saves a lot. You can overcome probably everything else in life. You are down in health, it's really difficult. It takes away a hell lot of time, energy, amount, your resources. So I would say budget is probably in the right direction, but a lot more should be done in coming years. Thank you so much.
Neha Gupta? Okay, I have bypassed you. How could I? Next year you are not going to enter, let me enter here. I will come to you later. Yes.
Thank you, and this from online to offline, this is quite exciting. Even CM budget meetings has gone online. So this looks very exciting, sitting here and talking about it. To me, this budget is very aspirational, at the same time very decorative. Why? This, our FM has given all the sectors, whether it's health or real estate, to disinvestment, everything, it looks a wow budget. But if we go deeper into each and every sector, so I'll be taking up three sectors. First, I belong to Federation of Rajasthan Trade and Industry, and that's a women, that's a big forum of more than 2 lakh traders, and we represent the women wing of that. And secondly, the real estate and women. So for me, this budget doesn't support economy, it just supports the economical headlines. The share goes up, the gold price goes down, wow, everything sorted, looks good. But by saying that, I might have challenged many views and opinions. So I would like to take you to real condition of our traders, our MSME sector. Because of COVID, they are bleeding. Many sector, many factories, many unit has been closed. But the current allocation of the budget just is a representation of a decoration. It is giving the amount in form of only reloading. It is not really reviving MSME. MSME has give more than 10 crores of employment. It is a backbone of our country, specifically for the state. We are talking as a whole, but we live in Rajasthan. And Rajasthan is mostly funded by MSMEs. It contributes almost 30% in GDP, and it comprises almost more than 45% in the overall exports. So leaving MSME in a sticky corner, I don't think it is going to the poorest of the whole lot. India is being called as Sone Ki Chidiya because of its traders, because of the entrepreneur skills which we have. And the kind of khwab jo dikhaya ki reform hoga V-shaped economy mein, as Varun ji has said. But this budget has shown a K-shaped economy which will widen the gap of wealth between rich and poorer. Why we want to leave our parental business of our trading, small towns, and see the glory of big cities and going to big houses for jobs? Why can't we the job creator, not the job seekers? So my next thing goes for the women. Women contributes 50% of population, but it contributes only 17% in GDP. Our FM said, Nari to Narayan, but Nari to Narayan only in kitchens. Not a single word has been stated for that. Not a single concern has been shown to increase the entrepreneur skill of women. If they are not coming in front, we are not giving them adequate support for increasing women entrepreneurship or women workforce, how we think that our economy will be boosted? And last, my core business, real estate, which I'm looking after from a while, and which is our bread and butter, it is doing very well. After 4 years, 5 years, after demonetization and all the regulations, it has come out from the dump. And definitely, this the current budget is also supporting affordable. Affordable are not really made by the big builders. They are concentrated on unorganized real estate market, but still it is good. So if the economy goes like this for real estate, definitely jo indirectly 300 se zyada chote or small business support karte hain real estate ke through, they will be definitely coming out well. So my take is, this is more of a glim glam, and if everything goes well, if it is all executed well, still we live in a state. And state funds comes mostly from MSMEs, small, and this kind of thing. So this is a very aspirational and decorative budget from my side. Thank you.
Now we move on to Mr. Sai Giridhar. Madam Gupta has completely a different take on budget. She, according to her, it's a bit decorative budget. What do you think, sir?
Yeah, morning, everyone. First of all, I'd like to thank Times of India for giving me an opportunity. It's always a learning experience for me to be here with all the experts panels. So, one, I like to clarify that I'm not an expert in economics. Very mushkil se pass hota tha sir school mein bhi. And as far as giving my views on budget, I'm not. I don't have the authority probably to talk about budget per se as whole. But what here probably I can do is I can talk more about my industry which I represent. I'm from the auto retail industry. We are into automobiles. Automobile is probably one of the sector which is most talked about probably during your breaks or over drinks. We talk about automobiles, so I probably represent that sector. If you talk about in revenue per se, we are the second largest contributor of in the organized sector after petroleum. So in any economics, automobile plays the key backbone, especially in developing countries. And from our sector, our basic requirement post COVID, post lockdown was that this budget should give us some sort of direction, some sort of support, so that we can again come back to the numbers which we were doing in 2018-19. Before me, the experts have talked about the V-shaped recovery. And in last couple of months, we've been reading a lot about V-shaped recovery, particularly in automobile sector. So I've read headlines which say that automobile sector is one of the sector which has rebounded the best, or it has come up the best, and there's a recovery. Month on month, there is a growth in our sector. But let me just remind you that probably our sector, we are down by at least 25%. If you talk about calendar year 19 versus calendar year 2020, we're down by approximately 25%. Per se, we're talking about approximately 65 lakh vehicles were the number of vehicles which were less sold in 2020. So, budget per se, yes, scrappage policy is one which even the moderator told us that the automobile sector has been given this. But again, it is introductory, though we don't know what kind of policy is going to come up with. But yes, if we take the 1990 as the base year, and if you're talking about commercial vehicles, there are 37 lakh commercial vehicles which qualify for this scrappage policy. If you talk about passenger vehicles, it is 62 lakhs. Even if 5 to 10% are still existing on Indian roads, it's a huge growth. But the only thing is that it's again with the tagline of introductory. So we are still waiting for the fine prints to come out, and what is the term of what kind of incentive? Because I believe unless and until you give something with incentives, or you probably encourage people to come up with the incentives, they probably might not come. Because still today in India, I don't think we have that kind of nationalism wherein I will scrap my vehicle for the health or for the cleaner this thing. So that's it. So probably it's only the scrappage policy. So it's nothing beyond scrappage policy that we have. Yes, the road is there, 6,500 kilometers of road infrastructure, which probably will help the commercial segment, which is reeling under a lot of pressure post demonetization. Thank you.
I now request Mr. Mahavish Sharma for his views.
The budget from three or four points. One is the government's point of view and why we see what we see and what happened, and to what Kunal had said, what year 2020 in revenues. MSME sector, because I'm in the handmade textiles, carpets, jewelry, and it's an important sector. Services sector. Angel investment, startups, entrepreneurship, and also the overall my viewpoint on the budgets and what budgets need to be. See, since last year, and I remember standing here last year, and a strong debate ensued whether the budget was good or bad, or the fine print was not good. The budget, what it used to be many, many years ago, has ceased to be the day where we should all be anxiously waiting for. Budget is a work in progress. What the finance minister or what any government comes up with is basically a revenue and an expenditure and allocation of those funds. During the year, you will see the GST council is different. So impact on sales, direct taxes, etc. will happen around the year. It keeps on changing. It will keep on changing. The government can change it anytime. So most of the tax is out. Income tax, as you read in the Times of India today, the Secretary Finance says that a year and a half ago, we reduced the corporate tax. We need to have stability. We have to have long-term vision. If we keep on changing the taxes by applying cess or reducing it, it's not good for the economy. And I agree with that. You know, they could have increased the lower limit, impacted the small micro individuals, self-employed, but maybe it would not have impacted the revenue much. Could have been a feel-good factor, but it's okay. So I personally feel that we should not pin our hopes on a budget or a one-day single speech on what policy documents are. And I'll give you an example and take up the startup ecosystem. 16th of January, The Prime Minister, in his speech for the DPIIT and the startup ecosystem, 10,000 crores of fund of funds, announced so many things that the budget for the startup, you know, domain was not required. There's already an advisory council under the Commerce Minister. There's already 10,000 crores that has been allocated to the thing, whereas Atmanirbhar Bharat and the medical and medtech and agritech and the job creating things are all allocated in the 16 January. So this budget and on the startups, I was not expecting anything anyways. And as a startup or as an entrepreneur, it doesn't matter what the budget is or what the levy. So long as I am a Honda dealer and he's a Skoda dealer, the level field is level playing. How does it matter? So as entrepreneurs or as startups, we need to pivot, we need to adjust, we need to work with whatever the government comes up with. So it quite honestly, to me, the budget is not as important as it should be. Now, the government has its own challenges. You know, revenue has been down for the whole year last year. We've suffered as individuals in a country. They cannot dole out incentives, they cannot dole out tax breaks, they cannot dole out all that. So we need to understand that they have to balance the budget. Priorities is defense, medical, agriculture and farmer, and the states that are going to elections. So it is, I agree with Neha, it's a decorated budget with lots of spend on infrastructure, focused on what looks good as India, what looks good as Atmanirbhar Bharat, what looks good to for the GDP. So they have, the GDP contributors have been checkmarked. You know, a Panwala and a Nai and a hair salon is not part of the GDP because they don't contribute much, at least, or even if they're making money or contributing, they're not part of the tax paying revenue bracket anyways. So they have to be ignored and they were ignored. So if defense, medical, health, agriculture, etc., automobile, roads, infrastructure, shipping lines, logistics, selling of PSUs, public listing of LIC, all these are impacting the GDP. So globally, India will be seen, and the V-shaped, so-called V-shape, will be more visible because the bottom of the pyramid does not contribute much to the economy other than buying an automobile, other than buying an apartment, low cost. They are contributing indirectly. They don't their revenue coming to the government is through that. So the government, only thing that they had to do was to bring up with a feel-good factor for that segment of the society, and they would have gone and bought an automobile or an apartment or gone for a surgery that they have been postponing for a year or gone and out and eaten at a restaurant. And so that trickle down or trickle up economy is what was needed. So I think that is where the budget, in my opinion, lacks. Otherwise, it's pretty much what the government could do best do under the circumstances. It really doesn't matter to us as entrepreneurs, as MSME. Yes, we are struggling. We are competing with China. China's of the world in the export sector, in manufacturing sector. We are not importing from China. Our infrastructure on the shipping lines, on containers is very pathetic. We need to put that in the right place. And I think those challenges will continue to have bearing on the MSME sector, especially the textile sector and other MSME sectors which are organized. I personally feel that we should not worry about what the budget says. We should, as citizens of India, as people who are contributing to the country by our taxes, we should continue to work towards creating jobs. We should continue to work and pivot according to whatever the law is. We will have to compete with the world. We will have to compete with each other. But I think budgets on any given day cannot decide the fate of an industry, the fate of a country, or the fate of its citizen. And that's where I would like to leave it at that. Thank you.
And it's a great learning, as some of the panelists have rightly said, that we are here to listen to the views from different sectors. And it's a great learning opportunity. So we have created this learning opportunity. It's a big thing, and I would like to thank Times of India and Economic Times for that. We have been doing this budget analysis, and we are talking about this particular fact, which has been very rightly pointed out by Mr. Sai, that budget, the importance of budget, why are we so sentimental about the whole provisions in the budget? If the budget doesn't talk about you, it doesn't mean that the budget is bad. If it talks about you, doesn't mean that it is good for you, right? So, mere mentioning of the fact that you are being mentioned in the budget fulfills the sentimental aspiration of people. So that way, if you start looking at the budget, there will be a lot of sentimental analysis of budget we can do. At the end of the day, budget is it a budget exercise, just expenditure and income statement of the government, or is more than that, or if it is a kind of, you know, policy document, as Kunal has rightly pointed out, and he started talking about it. Budget of late has become a policy document. It has never been viewed as a policy document. We had a very great economist like John Mathai as one of the finance minister of India, and he used to be the dullest finance minister India has ever produced. In fact, the finance ministers have never been very active and not talked about in the circles so much because of their, you know, state-of-the-art presenting of the budget. It has never been viewed as a policy document. Policy documents are like your planning document is a policy document. The kind of, you know, perspective 3 years or 5 years plan that you make is a direction that you give to the economy. It's a supporting document. So, but it has taken over as a planning document, or it has taken over as a policy document because of certain factors we all know. And one of the perspective in which we have to look at this particular budget is, of course, the pandemic. We have to look at that and what the rest of the world is doing and how we are doing vis-a-vis that. It cannot be an absolute measure for the Indian economy. We cannot just present that, well, Indian economy in isolation is doing good or bad. It has to be a relative assessment that we have to do. And budget, one of the way to look at the budget is that the day budget is presented, how the market reacts to that. And that's also taken as one of the indicator. And if you look at all those reactions that has come from the different corners of the market, overall, it looks like that the budget is positive because the stock market has responded positively. We also have seen, it has also been pointed out, the gold price going down, the BSE index we already have seen is touching all-time high, 50,000 is touching 50,000 now. One of the indicators that I would like to use is called the PMI index, that is called the Purchasing Manager Index. So Purchasing Manager Index, if it is less than 50, that means the expenditure on the part of the people are very less and they are not actually putting more into the demand side. And if it is more than 50, that means the economy is reviving, is slowly coming back. So if you look at the change in the PMI index in the last, especially 6 months, is quite tremendous. It's almost now touching 58, which is a very good indicator at the end of the day. But how I would like to analyze this budget is from the macroeconomic point of view. It's one of the analysis that all our students should know. If you look at the budget exercise, in my opinion, it has actually given a new and a fresh perspective to macroeconomics. And as a student of economics, one should actually sit down and think about how it is changing the character of macroeconomics and how the character of macroeconomics is changing all over the world. So the beginning of the macroeconomics is 1936 when John Maynard Keynes, the great economist who wrote the book in 1936, The General Theory of Interest, Employment, and Money, became very famous, and he was the one who actually advocated the role of government in tackling the problem of recession, Great Recession of 1929-30. So this is where the birth of macroeconomics, and after that, if you look at how the macroeconomics character had changed, we found that it ruled the whole world for a quite considerable time, this particular approach of how autonomous investment can change the profile of a country or induce the growth of a country, and importance of the autonomous expenditure, which comes from the government, basically, not the private sector. And if you look at the 70s and 80s, then this whole presumption actually came under cloud when we found that there is a crowding out effect that is happening in the economy. That means the excessive presence of government actually pushes out the private investment out of the scene. And the government, the expansionary government has actually entered into your bedroom and started manufacturing hankies. The job of the government is not to manufacture hankies. So, if the government is there to manufacture hankies for you, that's a very bad state of affairs for the economy. So that limitation should be there for the government, how much autonomous investment it can put into different sectors. And therefore, we found that 70s and 80s, where Milton Friedman actually came into picture, and then the whole scenario changed. And then they said that is the induced investment, which is driven by the rate of interest, should be looked into, and the monetary policy should play a very important role. And this is actually created a lot of polemic between Raghuram Rajan and the ex-the erstwhile finance minister, the late Arun Jaitley, if you look at the Indian conditions over there. And this polemic was very classic. And as a student of economics, you should look at the polemic of these two persons going on, how they actually shaped up the policies. Arun Jaitley kept on saying that put your stake on growth is important because growth has got trickled down. If you don't have the size of the cake bigger, how will you distribute it to the people? Right. So if you have small size of the cake, you end up distributing poverty. You don't end up distributing anything to anybody. So therefore, you should focus on the size of the cake. Raghuram Rajan kept on saying that, well, look at the inflation figure. Your CPI is moving above 5%, and then I cannot take a chance because it's going to hit the poor, and the polemic between the two. And then Hindu headline at that point of time, I remember, it says that the 5% growth rate is challenged because 5% is one of the lowest in the whole world if you look at how the CPI is being is behaving all across the world. So what is the point in looking at 5%? How is it going to hit the poor in that way? 5% is a safe limit where you can actually exercise your bet and put more on into the economy. Then Raghuram Rajan came back again and hit back again to the finance ministry and said that, well, 5% is because of the base effect. What was your CPI last year? Why didn't you look at that? So if your base was lower this year, it will look like higher. And if the base was already higher, this will look like lower this year. So the 5% is not 5%, it's actually 6 or 7% if you remove the base effect. And that's how the polemic actually, the tussle between the two went on. And look at the post-pandemic era, how macroeconomics is being shaped. Whole 90s and 2000 was the era when people thought the mix of the policies like regulate the interest rate is important, regulate the interest rate at the same time push the investment in the economy through autonomous channel. But now in the post-pandemic, you look at how much money has been spent by the government all across the globe. It's almost like $4.2 trillion that the government has actually spent all around the globe. It's about 17% of the global GDP. So 20% of the global GDP is being spent by the government. So where is the macroeconomics? Where is the interest rate? So typical thing about this post-corona situation in which this budget was framed is as follows. Number one, this was a supply chain shock. We all know that it actually abruptly stopped. That's number one. So when the supply chain and production will automatically stop, one can expect that the prices will move up for the commodities, right? That's the simple textbook economics. But where is the price? The prices are lower, right? So it was not a typical situation scenario of a fall in production that we visualize. It's the arrest in the market that has happened. It's a sudden arrest that has happened. And therefore the other dimension, the expenditure side. You know, people have actually stopped spending, so there was a demand deficiency, so arrest of the demand. So there was a complete situation where the culprits have been arrested and put behind the bar. And that's all the economy was representing all through. And therefore, it was not a typical macroeconomics where you can think about policy mix. And therefore, in this scenario, the urgency of the situation drove the economy. Right, urgency of the situation to drive the economy, and therefore betting on growth is very important. And today, if you are talking about V-shaped recovery, 11% growth rate, if you look at the projections for the next 2 years or 3 years down the line, it's not 11%. It's almost like 5%. People are saying that we are going to settle around 5 to 6% somewhere in the next 2-3 years. So why all of a sudden the growth rate will go down and again it will fall? Because there is going to be a leveling off, the base effect will go down, wither away, and the economy will come to a normal situation. And therefore here, the role of the government is not only assumed in India, but all over the world. If the role of the government would not have been that forthright to tackle this kind of situation, I don't think any mix of fiscal and interest rate policy would have helped at this. We are not talking about monetary policy anymore. We are just talking about fiscal policy. So this is how the macroeconomics is being shaped. So this is the new way of looking at macroeconomics. And this budget actually represents that new era. And if you try to say in other words or in a slightly political language if you want to use, we can say that is a textbook reply to Raghuram Rajan, which this government has given actually. So if Raghuram Rajan would have continued as a finance minister, there would have been much more fight by now, and things would have been very different, right? Because he represented other side of the pole, and the government is representing other side of the pole. So that's the how the whole business of economy is going around. Now, when I was a student, I used to study development economics, and in development economics, the beginning chapter is about the balanced growth and unbalanced growth. They talked about that. Unbalanced growth was propounded by Hertzman, and he said that the job of the government is to make roads, the job of the government is not to make buses. Because if the government makes road, then somebody will come and make buses. But if road is not there, nobody will make buses. That's what he said. And therefore, the job of the government is to create infrastructure. That's what he said. So the government should actually put all money in infrastructure and make good roads, create infrastructure, so that the private people can come and start doing their businesses. So government should either make buses, then somebody will come and make roads, right? If the buses are there, somebody will make roads. So what is that the government should do? Should it make the buses or should it make the roads? So Hertzman said the government should make the roads, because industry loves one thing, that is called infrastructure. If there is infrastructure, industry will grow. And industry, the job of the private sector is to grow the industry. It's not the government's job to enter into industry, right? So the government's job is to make infrastructure, and that's what the government is saying. If somebody is saying that it's a lopsided budget, of course, yes, it's a valid criticism, because it is a lopsided budget. Because they have, what the government has followed is the very typical textbook development economics, right? And then somebody contested this later on, Rosenstein Rotha perhaps, and he said that, well, the job of the government is to spend money or allocations evenly across all sectors. So if today government is not distributing evenly, or not talking about all the sectors of the economy, there is a philosophy behind it. So there is a context in which we have to look at the budget. In my opinion, it's a development-oriented budget, rightly said by the panel, that everything about recovery, everything about demand progression in the economy, everything about boosting the growth, and rightly so, because the growth has to be strong, and this is the call of the hour. If you start setting the houses and building the car or putting the carpets everywhere, you miss on the larger picture. And if your growth is not strong, tomorrow you're not going to fight out the problems of the world economy. And look at how the external sector is reviving. It's almost like positive growth rate that has come. Core sector, I will talk about core sectors if there is some questions later on. But how core sectors of coal, fertilizer, and other electricity is reviving. So this is very important that you create a strong growth. So I think this budget is very different. It's a very typical textbook budget which talks about strengthening the growth of the economy, which is the right thing to do and call of the hour. Thank you so much. I rest my argument.
Pankaj, for your detailed analysis. Now it's time for Mr. Anurag Singh. Mr. Singh, please, your views.
Welcome to everybody, and my hearty welcome to all the members of the dais. Mr. Minal, as well, another guest, fellow colleagues, dear students. So, I will be focusing on the basic postulates which has been laid down in the budget. So, I'm no economist, or not representing any industry here, but I have some interest in the area of the taxes, so I will be keeping my focus reserved in that domain. And like every year, I desisted myself from going to the newspapers, right? And because it carries a lot of clutter and it creates a lot of dissonance rather than any sensible thing. Before going to that, I must tell you that the famous play written by John Bernard Shaw, The Julius and Caesar, so it has a small description where Julius Caesar, one of his assistant, he noticed that Julius Caesar has crept into the revenue department and going through the textbooks, the books on the revenue and the taxes. So he mocked at him. King of a stature, of an emperor of a stature, of a Julius Caesar is going through the revenue books. It doesn't befits you. It's not your job. It's the most important job I'm doing, which is a tax. And at the end of the day, whether it's a good budget or a bad budget, it's not your budget, it's not my budget, it's the union government's budget. Right? They have to see exactly what is their plan income and plan expenditure and the deficit and how they are going to arrange for it. So rather than going through the newspaper and other things, TV debates and all, I thought, why not to pick up the policy documents? So I picked up the budget proposal along with the memorandum which was attached with the budget proposal, and I thought that let me try to make out what is there. So I will be, it will be little straightforward because it's essentially covering the direct tax proposals. And so I will be touching upon on most of the thing, but I will be focusing or speaking a little more on a couple of things which basically impact us or people around us. So first of all, as you know that for a senior citizen having an age group of 75 years, for them a concession has been done that well, don't get into pain of filing the return as long as you are drawing your income only through the interest income as well as the pension. But of course, in case if you have other source of income, for example, you're an elderly couple and you have got a house and that has been rented, then of course if the rental incomes are there, that has to be factored in and you have to file the return. Similarly, in case if you've got a capital gains and you have to provide for that, even if you have paid the taxes, but you have to file the return. So this is the one important thing. Then another thing is about the tax proceedings. So one of the very draconian thing about the tax is that, well, am I going to get served with a notice or not? So, and this is always a kind of at the back of our mind that, well, for how long we have to keep the records with us. So that period has been basically reduced. Earlier it was for the 6 years. Now that period has been brought down to the 3 years time. Of course, the serious tax fraud that has not been spared. So even in case if there is a serious tax fraud cases are there, it can be reopened after 10 years as well. Then the government has established a dispute resolution committee. So as we all know that in case you have some dispute with the tax authorities, then of course the first line of say your defense comes with the assessing officer, it doesn't help you over there, then of course you go to ITAT, that income tax applied tribunal. But now the everything has been basically, you know, more on the virtual platform. So you have to basically connect and write through email and get in touch with that, and the dispute has to be resolved in that way. And only in the cases where some explanations are needed, probably the video conferencing system has been provided for. So no more going to the tax or revenue department, and basically, which probably much to the help of a lot of people, because if you are served with a notice from the IT department, probably you get a lot of different things going in your head. Then of course the exemption from the tax audit, so that has been definitely a good thing has happened, because earlier the limit was 1 crore, that was last year it was enhanced to 5 crore, but in case if you got a 10 crore turnover from this financial year, probably then only it mandates for the tax audit. Then comes the very important point which concerns many of us, if not you then your parents, that is the dividend. Now the dividend income has always been a kind of a, so if I tell you that if you go with the traditional definition, it's an income, and if it's an income, it's liable to be taxed. But since good time, the dividend income was basically exempted from the tax, and idea was that people, rather than putting and parking their money with the saving account, they must put it into the corporate sector so that it should lead to the more growth and the more kind of employment creation. So the dividend income was exempt from the tax in the hands of the recipient. But at the same time, so government has to see exactly. So what they did basically, there was a dividend distribution tax was levied on the companies distributing the dividends. So 15% it was, otherwise if you add to the surcharges, it was coming out to around 18.33%. So in a way, you are basically telling the shareholders or the potential investors, you put into the stock market, put into equity, dividend income which you are going to receive, that is exempt from tax, but at the same time, you were telling the corporate houses, beware, in case if you are planning to pay the dividend, you will be paying additional 18.33% as a tax, dividend distribution tax to the government of India. So your total cash output for the 100 rupee of a dividend will be 118. So 18.33 would go to the coffers and 100 would go to the taxpayers, to the investors. Probably maybe desisting, many companies may be desisting from announcing the dividend. But does it result into the buyback? Very few cases we saw. So it's a basically not, this has been withdrawn. So the people who were basically relying on dividend income, especially they had invested into the PSUs, because if you see the PSUs, irrespective of the fact how they are performing, they are very consistent about one thing, that they are announcing dividend very regularly. So probably this thing has now gone, especially is going to hit the small investors. Rather, many of the people, they were expecting that, well, again, the exemption, because this exemption was withdrawn last year. So many of the people were of this mind that, well, probably it will be brought back. But that has not happened. So this is something, so you have to see exactly the tax arbitrage, is it possible or not? So you are more of a dividend kind of a person or a more kind of a capital gain kind of a person. So this is something which I would say which has gone missed by the government. And another aspect which merits some kind of a focus here is affordable housing rental things, Ms. Neha's area. So of course, the government has a focus on providing the affordable housing to most of its people, and there's already a deduction. If you see the standard deduction which comes under section 24, so 1,50,000 deduction is always there, and since 2 lakh deduction was always there, and 1,50,000 deduction was the additional deduction was provided in case if you are qualifying for that particular kind of a house, which government identified that in case if you are going for that, where the stamp values is not going beyond 45 lakhs, probably you are qualified for the additional deduction of 1,50,000. So clubbing together 2 lakh and 1,50,000, 3,50,000. So that has been enhanced by one more year. Probably this is again not very, very promising, because one more year, when you take a housing loan, you have to pay over a long duration of time. So probably one more year extension is not going to help in a big way. Nobody is going to plan just because of buying a house, just because of the one more year of extension. So probably this is one thing. Another area I think Ms. Neha would be in a better position to reflect, that this definition of affordable house, the 60 square meter within the metropolitan and the 90 square meter area within the others, tier 2 cities, how realistic it is. Really people are going for that kind of a house, and they can afford it. Some exemption has been given to the NRIs, because they come from other countries, they are settling down in India, then there is an issue regarding the financial year. So in many countries, we have a calendar year as a tax year, whereas in our country, it's basically a spread over the 2 years. And again, some relief is being there, though it has not been detailed yet, but just to avoid the hardship of a double taxation. Then comes the pre-filling of a return. Now this concerns everybody. So whosoever is earning and liable to pay the taxes and file the income tax return. So this is something something new has been brought in. Although whenever you apply for you are filing the return, you will always find that your salary details and the advance tax payment details as well as your TDS details are already pre-filled. Now this has been added along with the other things. So in case if you have some interest earning, you will be surprised to see that your interest earning will already be there in the file, in the return. Similarly, interest earnings are fine in case, but the capital gain has also been provided. Now, it's a little difficult. As long as you are dealing with the exchange traded securities, those information will be there. The cost of acquisition will be there. But for other matters, suppose you have sold the gold. So how are you going to assign the, say, cost of acquisition? So that is going to be a little issue. And again, you have to do the manual filling. But I think good move. It is going to save a lot of people. Otherwise, at the end of the year, you just rush here and there, seek the help from the experts that well how to file the return. So that is something good, I would say. It has going to is going to make the life much easier. Then some kind of relief has been given to the small trusts, hospitals, education institutions. So since good time, there was a blanket exemptions in case if your turnover does not. Goes up by 1 crore rupee. Now that has been increased to 5 crore rupees. That's perfectly all right. It is going to prevent a lot of window dressing. Now another thing which government failed to address, that was about, so I'm just touching those areas which normally concerns us or a salaried person, that is a LTC. So we all know that there is a provision of work, two journeys right in the block of a 4 year. And last year, because a lot of the people, they were confined to their home, they couldn't go and do a kind of a travel. So probably they could avail the benefit. So September, somewhere in September 20, this provision was brought in that, well, you can go for the cash voucher scheme, right? So you, even if you're not traveling, fine, you can get the kind of a LTC, and but of course there was a, some kind of a condition. So maximum 35,000 rupee was allowed as an exemption. Then there was a condition that you have to spend this money for those services where the GST is 12% and above. And good thing is, of course, that has been extended to this year also, fine. But probably there is some structural changes required, because LTC normally it covers only your travel expenses. But in case if you're going somewhere, you are staying somewhere, local travel expenses, hospital, this hotel accommodation, that has not been provided. It was a good chance for the government to even include these expenses in the LTC, because tourism industry, your hospitality industry, they are very badly, severely beaten up by because of the COVID, and perhaps this would have revived the thing, but somehow government missed on it. Then of course, labor welfare, every year this keep on happening, perhaps it was always there. I think it's a kind of a reinforcement with the Nirmala Sitharaman. She has done that in case if there is a deduction on account of the employee provident fund or other welfare scheme or say pension fund. And in case if the employer has made a deduction and they have not deposited it, then of course it will not be considered as a business expenditure, right? So it would be added to their income. So this was always there. I don't know why this has been introduced. Then last point is about the another concerning with the individual salaried class people about the provident fund. So there was people were parking their money into different provident funds, and even if it was going beyond, say, so now the upper cap has been kept, that in case if your contribution for a given year, employee's contribution I'm talking about, goes for 2.5 lakhs per year, then of course the interest income on that would be taxable, along with at the time of maturity also it will be taxable. So I don't know, but I heard that, well, there was a claim by Nirmala Sitharaman that there are people who are basically putting parking up to 1 crore rupee in the provident fund and availing the two important things. First of all, 8% of her tax-free say earnings, and so this is something which is very sure earning of 8%, and that too exempt from tax. So that thing has been addressed. Probably it's going to impact only the very creamy layer of our salaried class people. So this was my take on that. Thank you, everybody.
We now open the session for questions. Anybody want to ask panelists any questions, feel free to ask.
Given the figure around 9.6% for financial year 2021 and 6.8 for financial year 2022, so how government will be able to pull it down and credit rating, as you know, credit rating of the Indian bonds, Indian sovereign bonds is less than the HDFC bank. So high fiscal deficit will affect the credit rating, and in that case, how fund will be managed by the government?
Mr. Pankaj, you want to take this? Only you can take this. I don't know. I'm not in the place.
The fiscal deficit, we all know, 9.5%, but the government is saying that next year it will be 6.8%, so they have a plan to bring it down. But it's a bold state, because the government is spending so much of money on, and their stake is on growth, and therefore fiscal deficit is a very natural consequence of that. So without fiscal deficit, it cannot. But the if you want to see the brighter side in the budget, then you can say, okay, fine, even despite, you know, in spite of 9.5% of fiscal deficit, the government is not taxing or putting any corona taxes on people, right? So, you know, where from they are going to get it? Borrowing, of course, disinvestment, there's a lot of sources that they have actually. So it depends on a lot of assumptions that the money is going to come from this source or this source or this source. If that actually falls short, then of course the is going to affect the fiscal deficit once again. Now, second question, part of your question is that, is it going to affect the sovereign rating, credit rating? It's a kind of two-way sword, you know. Of course, it goes into sovereign rating, it might affect, but if you don't achieve high growth, or if your growth is not very stable, then again it is going to affect your sovereign rating, right? So it's a doubt. Which one are you going to bet on? Are you going to keep the Are you really sure that if you keep the fiscal deficit under control, like less than 5%, or as per the FRBM Act, as you have already envisaged that want to phase it out in the next couple of years? So are you going to do that, and your credit rating is going to go high? I mean, are you sure about that? Not very sure, right? So because your rating is also dependent on how stable is your growth rate. So probably it's a double-edged sword. So the government has to take the risk. So that's what the answer is, right?
I'd like to add to this. The fiscal deficit is not 9.5. It is much more than that. So this is also window dressed. So here we are trying to talk about the common man and all of us, and how does the budget impact us. The government and the fiscal deficit across the globe is huge. Indian government actually did not give as much money to what 17% average trillions of GDP that was given to people. Indian government's contribution was less than 1%. World over is 25 to 30, so their fiscal deficit is much more than ours. So I don't think that level of macroeconomics should be looked at. That's more political, that's more, World Economic Forum, WTO kind of a dressing, which you should let go and let it go by. It doesn't matter, and we will not be able to disinvest. We've not been able to get rid of Air India, and there will be issues with other disinvestments also. We will, a lot of assumptions on 120 lakh crores of GST per month will go up. All these assumptions are based on so many things. The fiscal deficit will be much more involved.
Okay, so this will add to this point. I'm just adding to where our panelists came from. So one is definitely you have to look at across the globe, what kind of recovery is happening. And since I'm a bit from health sector, I can tell you definitely India's name in terms of vaccination program or containing this pandemic, along with given that, as rightly said, we have spent maybe less than 1% on the healthcare spend, is being touted at WHO. So, and another thing where we say, budget, there you will satisfy few people sometime, all the people sometime, and some of the people few time, but not everybody all the time. What we have to say is what budgets have come, gone. One is market have reacted positively. We probably are not hearing so much of corruption, scam, which means what was budgeted, what was the expenditure budgeted, is actually happening. May not be to the full satisfaction of us, but yes, definitely much better in ways, So time to come, and if you follow the countries across the globe, there is simmering tension within China. What happened in Hong Kong? US is completely doesn't seem to be on the right track. Kind of events happened there. There is no superpower to say how it used to be. India looks very confident. There is definitely a lot of stability, what we seem to be here. There is a process. If there is deficit, doesn't mean we don't have money. We can get money. We have a lot of assets which the country is looking at monetizing and funding those. So as Mr. Bahal said in the beginning, the capital expenditure, the revenue expenditure which have been budgeted, are those going to be fine track? We also do in our corporates, we do our budget. And budget is a guidance. There's a guidance to it. This much we will do. This is kind of the expenses. And sometimes we'll not be able to control it. Like COVID pandemic, we say Ishwara Parma Krishna. Sometimes we are not the controller, and when we think we are the controller, we become a bit discouraged, demotivated. And we should always be hopeful, is our view. We should be hopeful, and by God's grace, India will do well, is what our take is. Thank you.
Dr. Varun, do we have prizes for the people who are asking questions?
We are giving the prize.
So this is one prize that you have already won, but I have a question. If any of you can answer, there will be a bumper prize for that. What is the difference between budget deficit, fiscal deficit, revenue deficit, primary deficit, and monetary deficit? If you can answer, I'll give you a bumper prize.
One of us.
Who is going to take up this challenge? Any of you? Even if you are able to say the difference between two deficits, you get the prize. I said fiscal deficit, budget deficit, primary deficit, revenue deficit, and monetary deficit. If somebody can explain monetary deficit, there will be a huge prize from my side.
Difference between the expenditure of the government and the income of the government. So it is basically the difference between the expenditure and the income of the government sector.
You explain the budget deficit. So income of the government and expenditure of the government. So total laga do, total income of the government, total expenditure of the government, your definition is correct. So you get the prize for this.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, sir, I have a question like related to the budget.
Yeah, please go ahead.
So like as the budget clearly stated that they help the MSME sector. Like the various textile parks are also being like the government said that they are inaugurated. But like we can clearly see that all the states that are the upcoming elections are in which states they are doing more for that. So don't you think that it is a kind of biased budget with the other states like us, Rajasthan or other?
We are launched sanction since 2007-8, 40 and then 20. Initially the infrastructure was developed by people who are in the textile sector. Now the government is saying they will make these 7 mega parks and will be plug and play. The infrastructure will be developed by the state or the central government, which is good in a way, but it's a very long-term impact. There's no short-term impact. All these announcements, the vaccine will be free, roads will be made, are all political in nature, no matter what the state is or what the country is. You and I also know that the roads in Uttarakhand, Haryana and UP are at twice the rate of development than they are in Rajasthan or Maharashtra. So that is all big because there are so many give and take that happen between the states and the center. And that always happens and will always continue to happen. You can't take that away. I don't take that away from a budget. So long as the expenditure is there and India is developing, I think it's okay.
But sir, the Modi government clearly prefers Gujarat, Surat.
So the Gujarat prefers Modi. So it is given, I said give and take.
Deficit is about the RBI's advances to the government. And that's the reason why, you know, it was found very inflationary in nature. Because in the past, it used to be very high. And it used to lead to inflationary pressure. So this was the process which was identified as monetization of fiscal deficit. And that's the reason, monetization of fiscal deficit. And that's the reason why the monetary policy became very powerful in the days to come. And that's why we replaced this system under FRBM with the wage and means advance.
Nehal wins the bump one bump.
I'm from, you know, giving the major highway projects to the pole-bound states. The government has really left a very important aspect of the budget, that is education, right? So the proposed spending on education stands the lowest in the last 3 years. It was slashed to 93.224 crores from 99,000 to 311 crores. Most important, school education has been hit by the biggest, but almost of 5,000 crores. This reduced spending has came at a time when the education's time is, you know, education sector is in dire need to upgrade with the COVID-19 pandemic. So interesting the thing is that last year we had this national education policy, right, in which it was clearly stated that a Ministry of Education is also set to start and implement the measure listed under the NAP 2020, which will advocate the increase on the education, you know, expenditure on the education sector. So what's your call on it, sir? Thank you.
3%, from 3% it has increased to 3.5%. So there is an upward trend in allocating budget to the education sector. So from 3% of GDP to 3.5%. But as you have rightly said, it's one of the lowest. Of course, it is one of the lowest. So one of the take I would have is that, you know, this should gradually increase and make it to at least 5% of the GDP in order to make your human resources stronger. So that is for sure. I'm with you on that. But the silver lining is that it has increased the expenditure on overall expenditure. And the overall policy of education is going to be guided by new education policy, because that is the policy which has actually changed or is going to redefine the education in our country, right? So on some other time, if you sit with me, I'll tell you the basic features of new education policy, how it is proposing. So in this particular budget, they have identified, they are going to identify 15,000 schools, odd schools, and they are going to implement at least all the elements of new education policy over there. That's what the budget says, right? So these two are good. For higher education, they are going to come up with a very wonderful idea, which I like the most. They are saying that they are going to identify almost like 9 or 10 cities in the country, and there they will work as a work on the coordination among the higher educational institutions. And this is one aspect that we all agree, that in an interdependent world, if let's say take the example of Jaipur, there will be a lot of things that we can learn as an educational institution from Manipal, from JKLU or from JNU, we can learn, and simultaneously they can also learn a lot from us. So interdependency has to be there, and there is no body which can coordinate or essentially bring them on a single platform. In today's world, if you talk about how Jaipuria is going to collaborate with Manipal, question does not arise, because we look at ourselves as enemies, right? As competitors, not so enemies, but you know, competitors in the market. So you know, this is one wonderful change that they are talking about higher education. But of course, no specific measures like opening of more IITs, more IIMs. I'm really happy about that in this particular budget. It's a very progressive budget in that way, right? But it's good. Indications are good.
But what is the government doing to build the local brands? India.
Basically, you want to ask, ये बोलते तो हैं बहुत आत्मनिर्भर,
आत्मनिर्भर
कर नहीं रहा है कुछ,
but ground level पे brands का development
हो रहा ही नहीं होगा. As professor said, the government should just build roads. You start from the top to the bottom. Brand building is up to us. It's to individuals or business people or entrepreneurs. That's one. Number two, infrastructure and logistics is something that the government should focus on, which this budget, in my opinion, does focus on. Whether it will be privatized and developed, whether it will be disinvested and developed, or the government is putting in roads, etc., etc., and the 5G auctions will happen. All these things are steps in the direction where, and if you look at what he had said on e-filing, e-appealing, ease of doing business, and corruption, I think someone mentioned corruption also. These are the other things that are impediments to building a brand. So they are trying to do that a bit slowly, in my opinion, because but when he came in power 7 years ago, there was far more emphasis on corruption and the previous government being far more corrupt than they are. It really did not, to my mind, it's not moving as fast as it should. But there is a step in these directions, and brands will be developed. Paytm is a brand, Zomato is a brand. You go out and you will see Ola is a brand. So these are brands which can acquire global companies. So I don't think that the government, it's government job, it's our job to do so. You start from the top to the bottom. Brand building is up to us. It's to individuals or business people or entrepreneurs. That's one. Number two, infrastructure and logistics is something that the government should focus on, which this budget, in my opinion, does focus on. Whether it will be privatized and developed, whether it will be disinvested and developed, or the government is putting in roads, etc., etc., and the 5G auctions will happen. All these things are steps in the direction where, and if you look at what he had said on e-filing, e-appealing, ease of doing business, and corruption, I think someone mentioned corruption also. These are the other things that are impediments to building a brand. So they are trying to do that a bit slowly, in my opinion, because but when he came in power 7 years ago, there was far more emphasis on corruption and the previous government being far more corrupt than they are. It really did not, to my mind, it's not moving as fast as it should. But there is a step in these directions, and brands will be developed. Paytm is a brand, Zomato is a brand. You go out and you will see Ola is a brand. So these are brands which can acquire global companies. So I don't think that the government, it's government job, it's our job to do so.
I'll just get that. How is it enabled, you know, as a economy or as a scenario? A lot of licenses are coming online slowly. The kind of hassles we used to have initially. It's not that we have reached 100%, but definitely there is a lot of improvement, there is a lot of emphasis. My brother works for a bank, and they have targets where they have to meet no targets for strengthening people who want to become entrepreneur from rural area or from whichever area it is, and it's being talked about around the corner. So it's again that hope element is that whether we want to drive it or not. It's not that we give our responsibility and put it by ye Modi hai, ye government of India hai, yehi mera business karte. Wo nahi hone wala. You are getting stuck. Are there any policy decisions you feel are not right? Probably that forums can be raised. Capital is available in the market. I am telling you, you have a good business plan. You can show the growth to the investors. Investors are there in the market. You have to work hard for it. Aisa nahi, you present to one and it will be given. We have hundreds of stories after stories, books are being written on them. So yes, we should go after creating brands, and it would be successful. Thank you.
I would like to add in that local brands is a state thing, and right now it is about union budget. So they are looking as a whole, and for the local brands, it is a state thing, and of course. जो पहला भी एक क्वेश्चन था कि दे आर क्लियरली कमिंग आउट इन टू बिग विद टू बिग हाउसेज एंड दे आर क्लियरली गोइंग टूवर्ड्स दी यू नो सीट की राजनीति. देर आर मैनी थिंग्स. आप जब तक पोजिशन में होते हो तभी आप रिफॉर्म्स भी कर सकते हो. सो वेरी क्लियरली पॉलिटिकली गवर्नेंस दे आर लुकिंग एट बोथ द थिंग्स. सो डेफिनेटली maybe if I can name मैं तो उससे न्यूज से नहीं हूँ. सो कांग्रेस में ये चीज़ें बहुत सटल थी और बीजेपी में ये चीज़ें थोड़ी खुल के सामने हैं. बट दोनों तरफ से रिफॉर्म्स भी हैं और ये स्टेट की थिंग्स होती हैं. और ये जो कॉन्फ्लिक्ट बिटवीन स्टेट्स और मेन यूनियन में है वो अभी बहुत क्लियर दिखती भी है कि ये सब कुछ जो फंड है. सो इट्स अ ऑल टुगेदर डिफरेंट डिस्कशन फॉर दैट.
इट्स अबाउट टैक्सेशन ऑन द प्रोविडेंट पीएफ थिंग. आई मीन लाइक व्हाट गवर्नमेंट वांट्स. दे डोंट वांट द सैलरी. आई यू आल्सो मेंशन इन योर स्पीच अबाउट द क्रीमी लेयर सैलरीड पीपल. सो आई मीन लाइक इन्वेस्टिंग इन दैट वाज अ गुड ऑप्शन फॉर अस. एंड to this session morning, I said my wife that I'm going for a budget discussion. So she laughed it out because she's a finance officer, and she said two things keep in mind. One, that do not speak because you're no expert, and second thing, ask this question. So my question to because both of us belong to that salaried class. So my question.
You must tell your wife that you did ask the question. So fine. So see, the government gives the exemption or deduction or allowances. These three things are there. So basic premise is this, that one should leave enough money so that you have disposable income. And at the same time, what is the idea that, well, people who are salaried class, they don't have any way. You are from government department. You try your level best. You cannot escape any income, right? It cannot escape the assessment. It's the right phrase. So this was for to give the benefit to the salary class people that were. So as you may be knowing, I mean, there are four different types of provident funds are there. So as far as in your case, it's a statutory, otherwise for others, it's a recognized other public provident fund. So already government has given you a concession in form of a say that, well, interest income will not be taxable. And even when the maturity will happen, even that will not be taxable. But if this 22.5 lakh rupee contribution per year, roughly you do a kind of a breakup, every month roughly 20,833 something would be contributing you. Is it going to be something, for how many people it will be around 8.33% of the basic salary? Try to understand from that point of view. So there will be very few people, right? So unless and until you have some other additional source of income, or you belong to that very high strata of people drawing a lot of salary, then only this is possible. And especially this is possible in the private sector, where you can sit down across the table and you negotiate your pay structure that it has to be in this way. You don't have a choice, even we don't have a choice. But at many times, I'm talking about the creamy layer, they have a choice that, well, my basic has to be like this. And that portion that will go into the provident fund. So idea is this, that somebody should not milk it. And the provision which has been created for it is for the masses, not for the classes.
But here the clause of the basic also has to be 50% of your total gross salary. So that is how, though what you said that 20, 3, 3, 3 is actually only 1% of the current population who is earning that kind of.
Yeah, so it is to capture them.
Yes, but then since now the basic, this essential rule is that basic has to be 50%, so then eventually within the PF, those who are still not falling in the bracket will eventually, maybe a few years down the line, will be there in this bracket. So because basic is now 50%, so
okay.
PF will also increase that.
So it depends which kind of PF you have. So basically your statue you get when you retire or you put down your papers. And if it is a recognized provident fund, then there is no taxes on your income. Income, interest income on your contribution. But if it is basically something unrecognized kind of a, then interest income of your income, if it is more than some state percentage, and the interest income of the employer's contribution, that is to be taxed. So technically, by and large, it is to be taxed. That was there, I guess.
Yeah.
Any questions? Any more questions?
Yes, sir. Just one question from my side.
Yeah.
Very good afternoon to all. Having enough knowledge of economics and all, just going through the newspaper today, and I saw Mr. Ghosh, Niti Chairman, he said government will be keeping only 4 strategic PSUs and the rest of the PSUs would be disinvested. So how should we take this as a sentiment for the overall economy, or as an individual in this nation, how should I take it this sentiment as, is it good or bad? This too much of disinvestment is going to hit the individual, normal individual in the economy, or is it going to boost the economy? I'm also seeing a lot of advertisement of LIC coming in newspaper just after the announcement of the budget. So is this the sentiment which would be prevailing after the disinvestment, or how should I take it as an individual, as an investor?
So is it too much of this?
No, it's very simple. This government has assets, they need money, they are selling it. To an individual like us, it will be better managed. It will be a better company, if at all, in my opinion. So it's okay if they are propagating that. It's perfectly okay. The government will eventually, Raja Maharaja ne bhi apne mahal aur khazane beche the, ye bhi Raja Maharaja ye bhi bechenge. Land and public companies are the only two things that they have. They will sell it. What is wrong in that? It doesn't really matter. Whoever is going to buy it is going to buy it for a bargain. And I agree, Adani's and Ambani's will buy most of it, and Tata's will buy most of it, but it's okay. It doesn't really matter. You don't want to buy from Hindustan Zinc, don't buy. You don't want to travel by Air India, don't travel. As Amitabh Kant said, there is so much competition worldwide. Even if Shipping Corporation of India is disinvested, doesn't matter. You use Maersk or other shipping lines. So it is. The world economy cannot be driven by any country's budget, I repeat. We are so much embedded worldwide, and this investment at this level is not a problem at all. US government hardly has any assets other than land and offices. They don't manage business. They've never done that. So India mein policy chali aa rahi hai from 50s, 60s. That is why this is needed, and it's good for the economy, in my opinion. I mean, I stand corrected if someone disagrees.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Please. May I just add to this? 5 years ago, I was doing a destination wedding in Thailand. I was working for a hotel then. So there was the host, so the lady who, her son was getting married. She said, I used to fly for Air India, but I used to fly for Air India in its golden days when Tata used to run Air India. And it came as a surprise to me. I wasn't aware that Tata used to run Air India, or Tata started Air India. And then the government bought it from Tata. She said, British Airways used to look at us and see what Air India is doing, and look where Air India stands now. So as far as your question goes, for a common man, I completely agree to Mahavirji that this investment at this point, giving such important sectors in the hands of private people who love to create brands, is going to just help us. It's going to help us get better service. It's going to help us get better products. And this competition is extremely needed at this point for us to grow by leaps and bounds. So I think it's great for us. for common man. Thank you.
Just to give you an example, I agree with our panelists. Just to give you an example, today, leaders of Congress party, they are coming up openly and saying that Adani ko chala jayega, isko chala jayega, aap yeh sa kyun kar rahe ho? I'm giving you an example. 1965, this MRTP Act was placed in the parliament for getting its approval, right? Trade practice wala jo tha, right? And it took 4 years. In 1969, it got the nod of the parliament. Kiska government tha wahan par? Of course, Congress ka government tha. Why did they take so much of time to pass? 4 years. They debated 4 years. They sat on the file. They could not pass it. Why? Das Gupta Commission. Just look at what the Das Gupta Commission said. Das Gupta Commission lagaya gaya tha us par. Just to see how industrialization is happening in India and who is contributing how much. So Das Gupta Commission said, apne report mein, ki industrial the state of industrial growth in India is very bleak, and whatever contribution that has been made in the industrial growth is by the private people, right? So if you restrict them in tooth and nail, so even this industrial growth rate will go, right? So we have treated public sector unit as holy cow, not to be criticized at all, but where is the efficiency? Where is the, it was supposed to be a model employer. Do we think that they are the model employer today? It should have stood for the efficiency. Where is the efficiency? Look at all these. So several things have been compromised. So I think it's a late decision. It should have been done quite early.
So Dr. Shaw, I have one more example. So the PSUs where we are seeing a kind of a disinvestment, I'm going to talk about something which was the finest of example of a PSU, one of the Navratan company of the government of India. I'm speaking about the Videsh Sanchar Nigam Limited. So cash rich company, because of few exclusive rights were given to them, including the DTH. Nowadays we hear about the DTH, it's everywhere. It was long back since 1940 onwards it was there. And having an exclusive right over that, including exclusive right to provide the internet services. They were the first internet service provider in India, and they were using the lease lines, right, for all the ISD calls and other things. What happened to that? I'm still talking about the times of Arun Shori when there was a Ministry of Disinvestment. And this company was basically almost 35% stake was offloaded. Of course, it was, there were two competitors, Reliance and the Tata Communication. And see what happened. They failed to do anything great about this company, BSNL. And after this acquisition happened, and Tata later on they increased their holding because it was a limited company. Very first year they acquired a whole of a network of a Tyco Global network, which is basically dealing into the submarine sea cables. And because of that, the Tata Communication became the number two in the world, say, internet service provider. So this is the beauty of giving it to the private hand, which is much better managed. Otherwise, VSNL, which is, I'm talking about something which was the best of the PSUs. And here, the companies which we are basically thinking that we are going to see this disinvestment, I'm definitely very sure that Air India is going to be one of those.
Disinvestment is the only solution for...
How the government will make money. Otherwise, what the monetary deficit was being discussed, which will give the rise to the fiat currency, that will be the issue.
So today we have enjoyed the legacy of all the Navratnas that were there, and saying that LIC today it is just making huge profits and just giving it to the hands of the private sector. It is very well managed and it is giving huge profit with all the product portfolios that it is sending. But just disinvestment, I believe, it's my personal opinion, cannot be the measure because these were the legacy in 1947 when India got independence, and then these Navratnas were established. And we have the Indian economy had grown with leaps and bounds by taking the advantage of these Navratnas and PSUs. And now, because of the inefficiency of the government to manage these particular organizations, we are saying that this investment is required. But I believe the other thing should happen, that efficient management by the government should be done to ensure efficiency. So disinvestment is, okay, we are having fiscal deficit. Disinvestment may be one of the routes to get money, but this may not be a
I would say, a trigger to bring a growth momentum in the economy.
Yeah,
there may be one or two failures.
We can have debate on that. You can have debate on that. But
yeah.
the point here is that the point that we are missing, and we have never brought that into discussion, is the rent seeking behavior. The entire rent seeking behavior has actually emerged from the PSUs. So question is that if there is government control cannot continue as a legacy. Would you like to have government control as a legacy to continue for all time to come? I mean, that's the kind of economy you want? Definitely not.
One thing, Dr. Prerna, I would like to add to this.
Yeah.
What is a better proposition? You are basically a LIC policy holder and you are getting your amount at maturity along with some bonus.
No, I'm
right?
saying it is efficiently managed,
right?
It is making profits
or
and then sending these efficiently managed corporations.
No, just let me put one last statement.
Yeah.
What is better proposition for you as an individual? Forget about, don't be so touchy about PSUs,
yeah, yeah.
Right? Right? What is better proposition? You getting your maturity amount along with some topping bonus, or you are getting topping bonus and your maturity amount along with the earnings in the form of dividend and a capital gain when you are holding the LIC shares? Which is better proposition? You tell me. And giving it to public private hand doesn't mean it will go to everybody. You would be the shareholder, you go and buy. You will be having a better say, better feel. You can definitely restrict the, say, FDI into that. No stopping.
No, I will just
all big companies nowadays,
yeah.
they face this thing. Even Nestle was a kind of a country where only it was restricted that, well, people from the Switzerland only, they can have this much of a share, rest will go to the rest of the world.
But at
so
least
you can
the
have
case of LIC, it is doing a better job than most of the private operators.
Yeah.
Who knows, sir? No, who knows? What is the guarantee? Who knows, sir? There is no disclosure.
What is the definition of efficiency? What is the definition
yeah.
of efficiency?
So who knows it?
Who
you
knows
being
it?
A company, I am basically supposed to file my returns. I am open for the audits and all.
Yeah.
But being a corporation, which is with the special privileges filed by the Parliament Act, probably my disclosures are not there. I have no idea exactly how much money they are making.
Getting because of the government tagline.
So you, which mobile connection you have?
I have Jio as well as Airtel.
Why not BSNL? And somebody
let's go to the next question. Let's go to the next question. We start falling in love with our kidnappers if we are with them for a longer period of time.
So just to ensure that it's not it's evened out a bit, probably from panel side also I'll take a disagreement with the panelists. I would say that what happens is, and we talked about mobile, right? So I would say that what happened to Vodafone. So it's about, end of the day is how it's being managed was rightly said. And what happens if it's governmentally manages, and since I'm from healthcare, what happens, we have Air India, for all said and done, the kind of losses they are making. When we had this COVID pandemic, they flew out every country, and it was, we were appreciated. Probably that kind of was not there in other sectors. You have seen in TV, ICUs in Italy, in Western countries where they are saying they're spending so much on healthcare. And it was such a, we were so frightened, right? We were scared to shit that what's going to happen to us. Did it happen to us? Not really. Why? Because still a lot of healthcare infrastructure is with government. They have the muscle power, in a single day they want. They can muster that kind of strength and deliver it. I am telling you, till date, 40 lakh vaccinations have been done. Highest. No, none of the country have been able to do. I am vaccinated, so I am from hospital. And, so definitely there is less riskiness if LIC is with government, because even today, if we come to economics of it, government bonds have the least risk. You go to any other bond, they have the highest risk. Of course, I am a from a private sector, you know, making all these statements look a bit odd to it. So probably because now there is a pro and con to each of this, I agree with what ma'am said, is that why don't as a nation we ask for accountability? Now, if there is a money invested, why don't we have a wonderful AGM meetings, you know, for the private sector? There is so much of being done, that this is how you publish your accounts. Questions are being asked. There is so much pressure from investors. Those pressure as accountability, and BSNL flop is not only because of the BSNL management. They were the best of people working there. I have people, my friends from quite reputed institutes who are working there. There was political interference. There were private lobbies. So if you are giving example of that, Airtel has is good. There is a case against Airtel Maxis, who is from Malaysia. So definitely there is private lobbying which comes wherein countries like US are struggling. We would not know that. So much of discussion happens on healthcare. Healthcare is a big discussion in Western countries. You know why? Because it is so much controlled by private lobbying. The drugs, the weapons, everything is privatized. And then government has less control. When it comes to benefiting the people of the country, it can be difficult, not just by humble take to this.
Please go ahead.
Okay,
this will be the last question.
So, sir, I have listened like a knowledge taker of the SP panelists, and there are different lenses to all this. Like somebody said, it is a developing economy, it's a textbook kind of budget, and there are lenses from various sectors. But from a general public, I just want, out of curiosity, a single sector is left out of the budget as well as out of the discussion. Agriculture sector. So is it deliberate, or why was it not mentioned in budget also? We have a lot of allocation for that sector always, but in this time budget it's been completely omitted. So I just wanted to know, out of curiosity, why it's been left out.
So with my limited reading of what I have read, we had our own budget discussions. It's quite exhaustive if you know in the company. It's not that it has been left out. If you take, and I'll keep giving you healthcare example, sorry for that. I am 10 years in healthcare, and when we had COVID, and the people, everybody migrated back to their village native, right? We didn't have people dying out on the streets. We had seen those pictures again in some of the countries. So I would say that India as an agriculture economy is still very robust. Majority of our food grain is being grown here. And coming to budget, there is a 17% increase in credit allocation, which happens to the farm sector in majority of the rural. So that is being taken care of. And I agree with you. So we talked about textiles. So textile, when we ask, raiment ka hai? Not really. No, raiment comes from cotton. Cottons come from a plant, and plant comes from seed, which gets into that field, where the kisan is working. So definitely agriculture is very, very important. They have done part of it, maybe more they will do.
Secondly, I'll just add to this that probably the government didn't even wait for the budget for agriculture sector. In fact, during the lockdown itself, they came out with a new reform. It's a major reform in agriculture, for which there's a lot of debate, there's a lot of protest which is going on. And then I guess on petrol and diesel, there is an agri cess now. Now, where that money will go, I don't know. It might go back to agriculture sector, but there is an agri cess on petrol and diesel now.
That will go to center. So state will now put the more.
So that's fine, ma'am. But I'm saying it will go to center. I agree, and probably they've reduced the excise duty. So probably it's going to take away the state's share, and it will go to the center. But since it's termed as agri cess. The particular budget or the particular amount might go back to the agriculture sector.
Now we have now come to the end of the session. So on behalf of ET and Times of India, I again thank you all for coming. Please go ahead.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, everyone, and all the panelists, panel member, for such an insightful session. Director, PGDM chair, I would request Varun Chotia sir to come on stage and present a vote of thanks.
So such were the times last year that we were all interacting online. So good to see all of you in the auditorium. We are having this session almost after the year. So I'm sure all students would have enjoyed the session and the deliberations which happened on this union budget for the last 2 hours. Before I proceed for the formal vote of thanks, I would like to just briefly summarize this year's budget from my perspective. So this budget basically had three prominent themes if we look at it from a holistic perspective. One was the aspirational India, in which all sections of society were focused upon from a better standard of living. Second was the economic development for all, which aligns with obviously our Prime Minister's motto of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas. And lastly, ours shall be a caring society. So, with these three prominent themes, the budget set up various objectives of achieving various major goals. Just to name few, the Sankalp of Nation First, doubling farmers' income, to which Rahulji was asking a question. I think there have been a lot of points which have been mentioned regarding the MSP which should be given to the farmers. A strong infrastructure, I think a lot of panelists have deliberated on that particular part. No wonder after the pandemic and healthy India, so the budget has seen a major chunk of money going into the health infrastructure, good governance, opportunities for youth, education for all, etc. So if we just collate all this and we put it under one umbrella, there will be six pillars on which the whole budget rests upon: health and well-being, physical and financial capital infrastructure, inclusive development, reinvigorating human capital, innovation and R&D, and minimum government and maximum governance. So if I just take these six keywords, that is health and well-being, I'll put H, physical, financial, capital, infrastructure, P, and so on. So I have five major alphabets, and if I can define those five alphabets, I think that calls for the conclusion of this budget. P, I would say progressive. I think Prabhat sir also mentioned that it's a progressive budget. H, obviously healthy, I for inclusive, M for mainstream, we are focused on the main sectors, and R for, again sir mentioned on the reconsolidation part, as in if we are able to achieve all this, I think the economy would reconsolidate for sure. So now proceeding to the vote of thanks, so on behalf of Jaipuria Institute of Management Jaipur, I would like to thank all our esteemed panelists, Mr. Sai Girdarji, Mr. Mahavir Pratap Sharma ji, I think he is not here, he has gone out for some urgent work, Mr. Ranjan Thakur ji, Ms. Neha Gupta ji, Mr. Varun Behl for gracing this occasion and sparing your valuable time and being a part of this discussion. Union budget is an event which all our students keenly look forward to every year, and I'm sure these discussions would have enlightened their minds. So again, a deep sense of appreciation for all the panelists. My special thanks to our respected director, sir, Prabhat sir, and Dean Academics, Dr. Anurag Singh, for being the catalyst behind this event and helping us organize this every year. In this line, I would also like to thank the team from the Times Group, Mr. Kunal Majumdar and all their team, which has been collaborating with us year after year for this particular event.